blessing, everybody. The Wongs. Hey, how's it? The Wongs. Brother Boo here. Hi, Laurie. Hope you're doing good, Laurie. Pastor David. This Brother Boo. How's it, Brother David? Hi, everybody. How's your week going? How's your week going?
Oh, going pretty good.
Oh, how come?
Oh, because Jesus is still alive, eh?
Oh, you funny, bruh. Hey, hey, Auntie Jan. Wow, look, there's Uncle Elvin there. Hey, Uncle Elvin. Hey, everybody. Okay, we're gonna get started pretty soon now. Where's all the kids? Hey, Haley! Where's the gang? Where's the gang? Kira, Michaela. Where's Alani? Hey, everybody. Okay. You guys doing good?
You funny, bruh. You funny, bruh.
Okay. See you later. Have a good gathering. Shaka.
Funny, that guy. Morning, everyone. Good morning. Good morning. Whew. Brother Todd, how's it going? Well, while I can, focusing on the screen. What's up, Anguais? Oh, I hope Haley is feeling better. Hi, Adriana. Praying for you and all of our healthcare workers, all the essentials. Love you guys. Aloha, Tomitas. Oh, Jesus is still alive. Aren't you grateful? We don't just celebrate one Sunday morning. And what a blessing. Hope everyone's week's going okay. I know there's struggles. We're going to keep our eyes on our Savior and King. Amen. Well, I pray is praying this morning. I was making this slide up. You see, yeah, that one. Your room is the living room of God. And I pray that wherever you're at right now, whatever room you're at, that it would be a living room full of life and His Spirit. Because we are the church. And I know His Spirit dwells with all of you and with us. Oh, it's good to be with you. Sure to miss you all, and we're going to continue to weather the storms by God's grace and continue to trust His amazing grace. Amen. So, Father, thank you so much for our gathering. Lord, I pray that wherever my brothers and sisters are at, the comforts of their home, I know, God, there's some things going on that's not comfortable. And I pray that today's time together by your Holy Spirit would be enlightening, would be enriching, would be refreshing, would be healing. Lord, Holy Spirit, come in and move and work through our time together. And we thank you so much for allowing us to be together in this way. Lord, let your Spirit be real through our worship, and we just thank you. Thank you for your Spirit's life in us. All right, sing with me. Let's sing a few choruses. Better than that, let's worship with you. couple songs. Breaks the power of sin and darkness. His love is mighty, so much stronger.
This is unfailing love.
Oh, this is a gift.
like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved.
Yes,
how precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone.
Give him thanks and praise for his unending and his enduring and confident and unconditional love and grace towards us. Thank you, Lord, for forgiveness, not just from our sin of wrongdoing, a forgiveness, Lord, that brings us into a living relationship that the resurrected King lives in us. We're so, so thankful, and we love you, Lord. We thank you. You are the blessing, Jesus. You are the blessing. Lord, I pray that while we pray for provision, Lord, for one another, a provision of health. And go ahead, let's lift up one another. Let's lift up those that you're praying for, that we're all praying for. Just the Lord sees those names that are rising from our hearts right now. We pray, God. We pray for the body of Christ. We pray for our brothers and sisters, the provision of health, the provision of work, the provision of finances to meet the needs, Lord, of your people. Oh, Jesus, we don't just need a cure from a virus, God. We need a cure for our hearts. And I thank you. We thank you that we found that cure, Lord. You have found us, Lord. You found us, Lord. And you've cured us. You've redeemed and restored. We live in that freedom. And while we're praying, let's just thank him for who he is as... What character quality right now do you think? Who is he's love, he's grace, he's strength, he's stronghold. And if you're with your family or someone, a friend there, just go ahead and share that. God is my shield. God is my comfort. And if you're just there, you and the Lord, go ahead and tell him, thank you. Thank you, Lord, for being my shield, my fortress, my rock, my love, my grace. We thank you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you so much, God, for just being that blessing. Let's sing this over just one another. And if you're just by yourself, you and the Lord, sing this as unto the Lord, right? Thanking him for this word and this truth. And it's a song that just came out. Carrie Job and her husband, but it's a scripture, the Aaronic prayer from Leviticus. Just follow along. Lord bless you and keep you, may his face shine upon you.
cross. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you.
That as we sing his word and proclaim this prayer, go ahead and pray this over those with you, those that we are. Let's sing this over our nation, our city, our government, our healthcare workers, our teachers, and Lord, the world. Thank you, God.
Lord, bless you. And keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you, Lord, turn his face toward you, and give you peace. Amen.
Our thanks. So it's not just our prayer, it's our thanks. We receive you and your blessing. Your blessing of peace. Your blessing of grace. And your blessing that you would look upon us, Lord. And it's not how righteous we are or not, Lord. How good we are or not. What we've done, good and godly or not, Lord, that you continue to look upon us with love and grace, Lord. So thank you for this time, and we continue to celebrate you and your life, Lord. And Lord, again, we want to just submit this time to you, Lord. It's a unique, unusual, bizarre, challenging time. Lord, we just pray grace upon leaders who are making decisions. I think we're all aware, God. You are aware. There's evil. There's corruption. There's evil desires. We just pray, Lord, let righteousness rise up. Let those who are trying to serve you, love you, be your representatives in our government, in the world, in our healthcare, and just throughout. First responders, please let those who know you, and pray that you would help grace them to rise up. Grace us all, Lord, to be people to rise up. But we just pray over our leaders, our government, these decisions that are vast, Lord. And we trust your sovereign work in and through them. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we thank you. Amen. Amen. Thank you. So good just to worship the Lord. I know that my wife and Malia and myself here and whoever you're with, or if it's just you and the Lord, that there would be a peace in the midst of whatever storms, whatever conditions the weather is like around you, around us. I receive that. I just feel that even now, just for my own heart, I feel that for our home. So may the Lord continue to speak to us. I want to jump into the Word here. I wanted to start this new mini-series, and it just intrigued me, just reading about Jesus after he was raised from the dead. So we'll get to the next few Sundays. We'll talk about Jesus's life after death and his interaction with his disciples, with others, and their reactions. And those of you who are tuning in on our Facebook page, I put out just the outline of the scriptures and some questions. So we'll get to that. I also did a little video about Bible interpretation, and we all desire to align and keep realigning to, you know, understanding the Word and then rightly dividing the Word of truth, and we're all growing in that. So I put a video out, but I want to review some of that. I feel it's so important for me. I'm hearing some things in regards to just questions of the, you know, is this the last days? When is Jesus coming back? And there's, you know, prophetic people out there. Thank you. There's words of the Lord, and I'm not sure what's right. I do want to align to Scripture, and all that said, you know, we can claim for health, provision, for wealth. And I believe there's promises in the Word, but we have to be careful not to use the Scriptures for our gain, but to allow the Scriptures to transform us, to allow the Scriptures to help us to grow closer to Him. And so that's our heart. And so we all come with different lens and views, and some of you have been around, you know, we like to touch on, I do love to touch on this because I think it's so important for us as disciples. One of our primary goals is to know Him, right? To rightly know Him. And Bibles, it can be very, very difficult to understand. Sometimes Christians and evangelicals, I mean, okay, we're saved and we know the truth, and then we start, you know, just sort of claiming or applying God's Word without giving heed to context. So some of you have been through this, but it's always good. I'm feeling it's always good to sharpen our hearts and our serve. So before we start in, let me do a quick review here. And I want to, hold on, bear with me for a second here. And this is on the video. I've taken this from a very, very good book on hermeneutics, how to study, interpret the Word of God, observe the Word. It's called Grasping God's Word. But if you have any questions, email me, send me a message, call, text about the material. But this is derived from Grasping God's Word. And there's a culture and a lay of the land, obviously, that the Bible was written in, and the times that Jesus lived in, and prior to, when we talk about the Old Testament. And so this section here is the Bible. It represents the Old Testament, New Testament, the times that the writers of the Bible lived in, their culture, their experience, their language. And so we have to consider that. We have to grow in understanding some of that, a lot of that culture and history. And then as we read God's Word, we have to realize that there is a difference of culture and language. And so this is sort of the river that sort of divides or sets a sort of a boundaries up. There's a difference between their culture and ours, language and ours, the times, the situations are different. So we realize that, and we take note of that. For instance, in Isaiah, who is Isaiah writing to? Right, we have to consider what is the context of his world, of his audience. And then number three, there's a principal bridge that allows us to cross over from Old Testament, New Testament. What are the principles that are timeless that do translate over into our world where then we can apply God's word? So number one is what does the text mean? What does the word mean then and there to that biblical audience? So that's why a good study Bible is very much needed for all of us. And then there's other study helps, right? And then number two, what are the differences? There are cultural, historical, language differences between the biblical audience and us. So we just take note of that. And then number three, what are the theological principles that we can extract from the text that does sort of translate into our, because not all scripture we use and claim for our day, right? And so number four, how does the principle fit just with the rest of the Bible that refers to context? And then how do we walk it out, right? How do we live it out? So what is the biblical audience hearing from that time, that day, Old Testament, New Testament? What's the context for that time? And then number two, just understanding there's a difference in, and so we take note of that. There's a difference in what's going on now as opposed to what Paul was addressing, the Corinthian church, the church of Galatia, etc. And then what are principles that we can look at and take, and then how do we then apply, considering kind of the context of the Bible, all right? So I know that's just a vast overview, but I wanted to touch on that just to kind of, cause our hearts to think more deeply about, as we're reading Scripture, we should be considering these things, right, of context, historical, etc. All right, so we can touch on that a little more. And if you have any questions, we'd love to, help with that. So as I mentioned, I want to begin this new mini-series, the Scriptures. I did post on Facebook, but my wife is going to, because you don't want to see and hear me the whole time. So yay! Come, honey, give me a kiss. Well, just show. It's all show. Nah, there's love. Okay, so I wanna start in on this new series here. I'm gonna go to my notes here real quick, and let's go ahead. Can we go ahead and turn that off, Maria? And that'll. All right. Thank you. The cool thing about our relationship with the Lord is we have this life that has been born in us, and it's by His Spirit, and He's opened and is opening our eyes to the gift of Him, and then the gift of His calling, and then we want to, as Christians, live for Him, as disciples, continue to be learners of God and learners of how to live this life out for God, right? In practical ways, as a husband, wife, as an employee, as a family member. And so what's amazing is that we have the resurrected King and His Spirit living in us. We obviously celebrate Easter. We celebrate resurrection and celebrate Him every day throughout the day, right? Christmas all year round. Easter, Resurrection Sunday, all year round. Yeah. And so, ask yourself, like, as we look at some of these texts in the next few weeks, like, what was the day or the week or the month like for the disciples, for people around after Jesus' death and His resurrection? So, we celebrate and we have our food and potlucks, this, hey, come over, we're going to celebrate. What was it? Potlucks, parties, feasts, victory, parades immediately after. We're going to take a look at some of that. And when He was raised from the dead, life wasn't peachy or rosy for the disciples. This is a whole new game. It's a whole new deal. And one of the questions there that I put on the notes on Facebook, what did Jesus' life look like after his resurrection? And how did his life after his death and resurrection affect the disciples? How did his disciples, believers and others respond to Jesus? And I believe as we look at that, the Lord's Spirit's going to help us to glean from those characteristics, from those responses, challenge, test, convict, encourage our hearts to live our faith out in ways that he is leading us. So what was Jesus' life like after his death and resurrection? And what were the others' lives like too, their responses? Well, we're going to look at Matthew 28, verses 5 through 20. And I'm going to have Beckie read from verses 5 through 8. So turn in your Bibles, Matthew 28, verses 5 through 20. We'll begin with verse 5, and you'll read through 8. Okay. All right, go ahead, loud and clear.
The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples.
So again, it's noteworthy to see that the angel revealed this to the women.
The women.
Right? The women. Mm. I mean, I think there's a significance to that. And again, it's not to divide who's better, etc., but there are some cultural, sort of social implications there, because women in that culture, even leading up to now to a degree, are second rate. They're not as esteemed, right? And so I think that was significant that God would bring that out through his word, yeah. And that would happen.
So do I. That just excites me. Sorry when I hear that the women...
Don't be sorry.
...were the first to witness evidence of his resurrection. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That to me is, I'm very thankful that God recorded it that way in mm-hmm. scripture mm-hmm. because of what you just said. You know, they witnessed his life, his crucifixion, his yep. burial, yep. and then the empty tomb.
Right. Right.
And then they shared that with the disciples.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And again, there's so many sort of tracks or trails we can kind of go down and talk about, but when I think of one aspect of women, of this being revealed to women, and how throughout society women have been downplayed, degraded in a number of ways, women, God uses, I mean, it's he created man and woman, and the woman is the one who bears life. I mean, such a, like, wow, I'm thankful men don't get pregnant.
but they can't do it without the man,
right.
So.
But the whole idea that the significance of life coming forth through women, again, that's one huge aspect, right? But there's so many other kind of implications here, but here the angel said to the women. But let's look at their response. Look at that text, 5 verses 5 through 8. I mean, what are some responses that you see? I mean, there was a sort of a command or direction. Come see the place. So obviously the women were there. They come and see the place. Then he said, then go quickly and tell his disciples. So there was instruction given, he's risen, and now I've told you. And so verse 8, what's that response? The women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy. So again, there's So there's mixed emotion. When I can't imagine, we're just trying to unpack this, but there's mixed emotion based on this miraculous event, right? And it wasn't the first time, I believe, that they heard of resurrection, right, like Lazarus.
Right.
And even in our day, I mean, I've heard of testimony of people being raised from the dead, right? And so it wasn't the first. So what made it shock? So that's my question too. Mm-hmm. What made it shocking for them? Was it just, oh, he was raised from the dead? Well, there were other miracles of his resurrection. Lazarus was one, and I'm sure throughout even history there were others. But what made it shocking that there was a fear and yet great joy? Here, I want to submit this to you as I want to submit this thought to you, because it's not that, okay, just another person was raised, but think about it. Again, this is, I mean, when I say it, it's going to be like, oh yeah, duh, Rod. But other people were raised, resurrected miraculously. So what made this shocking? Because not that I think Jesus was raised, it's that God sent his son. It's God in the flesh that came to humanity. And all of what was going on throughout Jesus' ministry here on earth, it put a wedge in the way society thought, the way the Pharisees, the way the Jews. It was a fully disruptive theological situation when the God-man came. And so fast forward, what, he's not here? So I'm want to propose to us that part of that emotion is that, not again, he's raised, he's alive, but why, who is he? He's Messiah. It's like God, he is God, that he came to redeem, that the Messiah, I mean, it was a fulfilling thing for the women first to hear that, right? Does that make sense, hon? Because, I mean, the other thought, one of the main thoughts for Jewish culture was that a Messiah was going to come, right, to bring his kingdom, establish his kingdom, set up rule, and I don't know about wipe out the Roman, Persian, yeah. But that there would be another Messiah who would come with a huge chariot. And so it just wasn't that way.
Right.
So I'm just saying, the women were like filled with exuberance. We'll later see they worship. It's God. God, Father. Jesus is God. Yeah. He's the way, the truth, the life. So that was the exuberance. And then I'm wondering about the fear. I thought, like, why are they fearful?
Well, it could be more of a reverence kind of fear, too.
Okay, it could be, yeah.
But I know that that's part of
but,
it.
But again, even so, the angel said, don't be afraid. Jesus, don't be afraid. So maybe that reverence, worship, but also, like, fear. Why would we be fearful? I've been fearful. I've had a little bit of fear of proclaiming his name out in public, because I'd be seen as right. So it's the idea of for them, I think, the fear that this is God, the resurrected King, and whoa, what we believed,
yeah,
right, is being fulfilled, but he radically changed Old Testament law, came to fulfill it. And so customs were going to change. That's what Jesus was talking about with the Pharisees. So I think the fear of, how are we going to live this out, right?
Yeah, game change.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah. And so I think part of the application would be, now, how are we going to live this out for Jesus, new set of rules for us with what's being written into law, taken away, rights taken away. I mean, just...
new lifestyle.
Yeah, it's a new life. It's a new lifestyle. And, yeah. So I just see that as part of, you know, the tone of this passage. And let's continue on verses 9 through 11. Verses 9 through 11. Go ahead and read.
Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped or held his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." While the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened.
Yeah. So again, same scene, right? The women on their way, Jesus himself appears. And there's maybe a reverent fear, right? Because they did worship him. They clasp his feet. I mean, the imagery is a falling down. That's what worship is in the Greek, to kiss, to bow down. And that's what they did, to that bowing down and holding on to his feet and worshiped him. But he also said, "Don't be afraid." So again, we all live with, as Christians, I mean, this heart to love him. I know I have that heart, and you do too. Just that heart to love him, to worship, to give yourself to him. And how are we really going to live this when other aspects of life begin pressing us? Viruses, stay at home, finances, losing job, health, right? Is there going to be emotional, just hardships, right? Within the fear, the anxiety, worry, and yet the women. So again, this is another response, right? What did they do? They went. They continued, because Jesus, he said, "Don't be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go." And so again, the idea is, here the women were the responsive ones,
yeah,
to go, to obey the word of the Lord. What area right now, for yourself, is God saying, this may oppose what you're living in right now, but you go, you obey me, right? You hurry to obey me, as opposed to what was going on and yielding to maybe the surroundings of, because could they have been more afraid of the guards? The guards went into the city, reported, so I mean, that's a whole nother group of people, right? That response of the guards and the chief priests and everything there. So there is going to be an effort for a great cover-up. So let's look at verse 11 through 15. So just go ahead and read 11 through 15.
Some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. When the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say, 'His disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep.' If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. And this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day.
So again, this is Matthew writing to his day. So the story was circulating. Here he wrote this gospel years later, describing, illustrating this narrative. And then he's saying that story was still circulating years after. What story was that? That soldiers took money, etc. So you look here, who the players were. Soldiers, spiritual leadership of that day. I mean, this is like the spiritual leadership, the Jews, God's people, right? And so Jesus, God in flesh, is raised from the dead, and he is who he says he was and is, the way, the truth, the life, right? So there's a shock fact. He's alive, not just because the miracle of a resurrection, but the miracle of the God-man. I mean, that, right? That's huge. And so here now, whose world is being, everyone's world is being affected, including the soldiers. I mean, they had their lives taken away from them because death was the penalty for soldiers in this kind of situation. And so you see here the big conspiracy, the under, the covering up of thing. Wow, interesting. Well, how does that apply? Do you ever, happens in families, cover-ups?
Falsehood.
Yeah. Workplace, where people are slighted, changing stories, right? I mean, you know, gossip, etc. But because they're not wanting to follow your truth, maybe our truth of knowing Christ, there's going to be opposition, yeah. Right? Which is attention. And then, I mean, yeah, this is not the time. And I think of the news that we do watch, and then I think we even have to watch the news we do watch. I mean, anyway, I won't get into that whole thing. But when it comes to politics and what's going on, we are very much in a political driven society and world, and a power hungry culture. And so you and I know there's cover-ups, there's deception. I can't imagine. I just can't imagine. So I mean, let's not like live in that dark lane, but we need to recognize we realize it's going on. Okay, what's the application? Well, if we realize it, we pray, right? We pray for leadership. We pray for spiritual leadership. We pray for one another. We pray for those in political office. We pray for those spiritual leaders who are of influence in and with those, and Christians who are in the government. And then, I mean, it goes on in society. As first responders, healthcare workers, and teachers, and I mean, every one of you, that we would be the kind of representatives that when we see and even experience being slighted, something being covered up, our response is what? Definitely pray. Definitely pray, and continue to obey. Keep our eyes fixed on Him. Right. So the assignment for the ladies was, hey, don't get distracted. With the chief priest. I mean, who knows what kind of our lives are going to be taken, right? But they focused on their call and assignment to go. So day by day, moment by moment, let's be a people who pray, who listen, and we're obeying the Lord in the midst of our situation where there's strife, opposition, when there's conspiracy, gossip, whatever it might be, hardship in relationships. We keep our hearts set on Him.
Yeah. And yeah. Can I say, and pray? We pray that the truth would be revealed.
There you go.
Because that's what needs to happen.
Yeah, that's it. Bam!
That's pray why for truth right to be revealed.
Yeah. So let's continue in that passage, 16 through 20, Matthew.
Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Mm-hmm. Then Jesus came to them and said, All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age.
Yeah. There's just much in this passage. And what I want to highlight here is the 11 were exposed. 11 disciples went to Galilee. Jesus told them to go. They worshiped. So their response was worship. But these three words stood out to me. But some doubted. I mean, I know where to go. I know what God's doing in my heart with that phrase. There's a reality. You ever doubt, right? Ever doubt God? I don't know. I'm just personally one that, as a spiritual leader and one who's just growing as a servant of God, I don't want to minimize doubt. We doubt. We deal with that. I don't want to stay there. I want to encourage people with truth, right? But it just stood out to me. We're going to have people around us that doubt. Us. We doubt. We have fears. So I guess what I'm kind of drawing from this is let's not be, I don't know, I just don't want to put on a mask, try to be super Christian and say, I'm not human that way. I recognize, you know, those emotions, those real feelings, and they can drive a wedge in relationships, and we get that. But we recognize it, and here Jesus, he says, even to those who, I believe, doubted, even along the way in his life, in his ministry, right? He taught to his disciples who believed, and when they didn't believe, I mean, he was steadfast, and he says, hey, I'm with you. I'm with you when you believe, and I'm with you when you doubt. But focus on what? Okay, go and do. So there's that commission, a focus. Now he reveals himself and talks to the disciples. So Matthew kind of fast forwards to this scene here. So I don't know, any thoughts on that? I don't want to, there's so much within
there's
the
so
Great
much
Commission.
There, but I love it. Go and make disciples of all nations, mm-hmm. You know.
Yeah.
It's global.
Yeah.
It's worldwide. Yeah. It's not just where that happened.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's, so sorry, I'll bring that up.
Don't be sorry.
Okay.
We need her to talk more. We be silent when we talk. So yeah, there's again that call and focus. And so what does that mean to you and I right now? And so my prayer is that would stir your heart. What does that mean to you now? To go. To take truth. To be the light bearer, the love bearer of Jesus. And to encourage and to make disciples. And it's, again, not just about reaching, witnessing the unsaved. Okay, I mean, that's all included. So sometimes we say, go make disciples, like we got to go evangelize, which yes, that's huge. But it's all wrapped up in there where we are encouraging one another. There's people, there's disciples diminishing, falling away, discouraged, disheartened. Some of you may be, I mean, we need each other. We need to continue to speak truth and life to one another. But realize, hey, some live in doubt. Some live in fear. And we can't just, you're holding me back. You're pulling me down. I mean, we all get it, right? There's people who are drainers. It's like, wow, you just can't get out of that fear. All I'm saying is, let's obey the Lord as disciples, realizing there's some that doubt. Maybe it's the Lord sending us. He's with us, and we are called to make disciples of that person as well, who's weak, who's hurting, who's in need as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right, we're gonna close out with this portion of Scripture in Luke 24. So turn in your Bibles to Luke 24, and then we'll make a few comments from this passage, and then we're going to continue on next week out of the book of Luke as well. So rich when we're soaking in, just looking at the word. So go ahead, let's read.
Luke 24, 9 through 12. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened.
Let me back up. That's why, for me, in my study in the Gospels and the various writers' responses and what they've gleaned from and what they write about Matthew and Luke and Mark and John. You even touched on Mark and John. But they each have a view and the truth of what their perspective, right? So here's Luke's perspective here of a scene. And again, some of them condense a little more, but here's Luke's perspective and in his writing. And the disciples are told, of course, the women there address and bring that bring the news to the disciples. Verse 11.
What's that say?
Verse 11. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. But Peter, you know, Peter, that guy say, we can go off on Peter, right? Peter. Oh, Peter. The rooster crowed. He denied. He took his eyes off of Jesus. He's rambunctious. I didn't relate to Peter. I want to relate to Peter now. But Peter. That's... So, man or woman, younger, elder, we have that. That's us. But Rod. God's given us that faith, that heart to obey, to trust in a word that God has given someone that, not that you despise, maybe someone will bring a truth to you. Listen, the Lord may send an angel, a prophet or a prophetess in disguise. I mean, they're not even named or titled. They don't have to be named or titled. They're a servant of the Lord. But Peter ran. It's like, there's something there in that truth. My sort of point, and I feel like it's a word of the Lord for some of us, let's be attentive to the Lord in our spirit, not just blow people off in terms of their hearts and hunger for the Lord. Because these women were that, like, so again, here's these women, discounted. Are you kidding me? Nonsense. There may be people around us, and again, there's so many different circumstances, but I'm just saying be attentive. Because there may be people around us that just may be just desiring to encourage, to speak a word, but you'll hear something by the Holy Spirit from someone that you wouldn't have thought would speak truth to you. I'm just saying be open, be attentive. Because if your heart's to follow the Lord, I believe Peter was like, whoa, wait. He was recalling maybe different things in the garden, right? And he went and he ran. So that, again, that obedience to the Lord, and yet there are, I don't want to be like the ones who's saying, nonsense, yeah. Right? Just, I can be so quick to judge. I can be so quick to declare what I believe without really listening. Oh, you know that, hon. Okay, yes. Sorry, I'm the one to say, oh, sorry, hon. And I wrote this down on the Facebook post, but I want to close with this. What scene, What situation or person speaks to you out of this text as you meditate, as you review this? Whose reaction and response can you relate to? I know we've been talking about that. And why? What do we learn? Here's kind of the most important. What do we learn about Jesus and his life and his character, even through these texts? So go back, review, and see what the Lord continues to unpack and unfold. And use these questions. You can discuss in your small group, with your family, just offline. And I'm going to conclude just with a prayer for us. And thank you. Well, again, just I pray, we just all thank the Lord for his word, his spirit that speaks. And whatever's of me and my opinion, etc., yeah, you'll be able to filter that by the Holy Spirit. But we're praying the Holy Spirit's truth, like you said, we want his truth to continue to fill us, that we would marinate in that truth, and that we'd be led to live that truth out. That's the church rising up, right? So let's pray together. If you're online, just struggling with your relationship, just cry out to the Lord. Just talk to the Lord. Rededicate your heart to the Lord. I give you my heart. If you're watching so you're kind of falling away, or even may not have really received Christ in that way, you just right now, you're believing, you're stirred. Just say, God, I welcome you into my heart. Jesus, I'm believing. I have doubts. I don't know what this is like. Again, just be honest, but I need you. There's something resonating in my heart. I believe that's your Holy Spirit. Just pray that. So, Father, as we kind of close this time of our gathering off, may we continue to receive and welcome your Spirit's voice, your Spirit's leading, your Spirit's power and love and grace within us to know you and to live for you. Thank you that your life after death and being raised again is living within us. That same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in us. And the Godhead, the fullness of the Godhead deity dwells in us. So we receive. Just go ahead and just say thank you. We receive the fullness of your presence, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in us. We love you, Lord. We love you. We thank you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. I love you all. And this, on the 20th, we've been having a little more praise and prayer worship times, not waiting for the 20th. But those of you part of the Manoa Ohana, on the 20th of each month, 2020, right? But the 20th each month, just asking all of us to choose a fast, but to pray. We're all praying every day, but dedicate, devote, set aside some extra sort of intention and heart to fast, whatever you'd like to fast, social media, this, a food, a drink, whatever it might be, and to sort of give yourself to the Lord and surrender. And then on the 20th that night, we're going to have a worship and prayer time. Continue to pray for one another, for our nation, government, and things that are in our hearts, a church and community, etc. So the 20th, which
that's
is
tomorrow.
Tuesday. Oh.
No, that's no. Tomorrow.
Wait, it's tomorrow? It's tomorrow. Yeah. It's tomorrow.
Monday.
Yeah,
Monday.
Okay. Yes. Thank God. Oh, thank you. Love you. All right. She's so good. Yeah, so let's do that. Oh, I was thinking Tuesday. Let's do that. So be in touch, and love you all, and let's just continue to grow in connection with the Lord, with one another. All right. God bless you. Love you guys.